All praise are due to Allah, the Creator, the Cherisher, and the Sustainer of this universe. And may His peace and blessings be upon His noble Prophet Muhammad, and his descendants, and his companions, and his followers. Dear respected brothers and sisters, the people of his tribe used to love him so much. And even the pagan tribes of Arabia loved him too and had an immense respect for him. They even saw him as the wisest. They saw him as the wisest man in Arabia. So they even appointed him to be the arbitrator in very crucial matters that could have caused wars. And his verdicts were always accepted from them with happiness and respect, to the extent that they called him the trustworthy and the truthful. But all of that changed as soon as he said La ilaha illallah, there is no God except Allah. Suddenly everything changed. All this love and all this respect changed to hatred. And they tried to tarnish him. By all means, they called him lunatic, crazy, sorcerer, magician, poet, who authored the Quran and claimed that he received it from God. They tried to kill him. They tried to torture him and his followers. And of course, he was shocked. He was so surprised. What happened? Where is all the love and respect for me? Why did it all change to hatred? He was really surprised. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him the answer from about seven firmaments, telling him that it's nothing personal, it's not about him. It's about the message that he came carrying to them that they cannot bear. They are not ready to change. They do not want to change. It's not they are not ready. They do not want to free the slaves. They do not want to give the women the rights that are due to them. They are not ready for that. That's why it changed into hatred. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ. They are not rejecting you personally. It's just that the evildoers reject the message of Allah. And instead of taking him as example, they mock him. They mocked him and they keep mocking him. They mock him as a husband. While 80% of the marriages fail in the first 3 years in their societies. And they mock him as a husband instead of taking him as an example. They mock him as a leader of a nation. While their societies and their nations are getting destroyed by racism, they mock him as a warrior. While tens of millions of innocent civilians died in their crazy wars. Instead of taking him as example, they just mock him. What's our duty towards him? To take him as example. He's our example. And many of us, alhamdulillah, try to emulate him. As a husband, we try to emulate him. As a parent, we try to emulate him. As a teacher, we try to emulate him. As a da'i, we try to emulate him. As a friend, we try to emulate him. But who of us try to emulate him as a abd, as a slave, as a servant? He was a abd. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him many names, many honoring names, honoring titles. But the most honorable of all of them is Abdullah. This is the most honorable title for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts Surah Al-Isra by saying, سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. Glory be to the one who sent his عبد, who sent his servant in a night journey from المسجد الحرام to المسجد الأقصى. Allah also says, ولما قام عبد الله يدعوه كادوا يكونون عليه لبدا. And when the servant of Allah, when the slave of Allah started to pray, they came and crowded him and were about stifling him. So Allah called him Abd. And this is how he looked at himself, as he Abd. He sat down eating and he bowed down while he sat down on the floor to eat, and he bowed down until practically he became like prostrating on the floor. His head was about to touch the food of the floor. And Lady Aisha looked at him and said, why are you doing this to yourself? Why don't you sit comfortably and eat comfortably? Why don't you tell me to bring you something to lean on, like a cushion or something? He said, who am I? I am nothing but a servant. I sit like a servant and eat like a servant. This is how he looked at himself. When he entered Mecca, he entered as a conqueror. He conquered Mecca. It was a grand victory for Islam. We're talking not about Mecca that we go to today to do Umrah and Hajj and buy things from Bin Dawood. No! We're talking about the biggest enemy of Islam at that time. The capital of Arabia at that time. One of the biggest capitals of shirk all over the world. 360 idols surrounding the Kaaba. We're talking about the city that its people, which its people rejected the Prophet ﷺ and tried to kill him and killed some of his followers. And the first martyr in Islam was Lady Sumayya. An Islamophobe jabbed her with a spear in her private parts. We're talking about the city which its people killed the uncle of the Prophet, Hamza, and mutilated his body and ate his liver. We're talking about Mecca that had put the Muslims under embargo for 3 years in Sha'ba Abi Talib. The Muslims starved for 3 years. They saw food, but they couldn't eat it. They can't buy it. No one is selling to them. No one is buying anything from them. They starved. They ate grass. Literally, they ate grass until their feces looked like those of sheep and animals. When he conquered Mecca, how did he enter Mecca? Like a defeated person. Like a conquered person. He entered bowing down with his head literally touching the neck of his camel. Why? Why did he make a point of doing that? Because he was conquering himself. He was conquering his ego. Who of us is taking him as example in doing so? In being a servant of Allah? In conquering his ego? I want every one of you to imagine that he receives somehow today a message from Allah telling him that he has been forgiven all his sins, past sins and future sins. Just imagine that Allah sends you now a message somehow that you have been forgiven all your sins, past and future sins. What do you think would be your reaction? Will you stand up the night praying tonight? I'm sure many of us will take a vacation and maybe run to Disneyland in France. Because class, done. I got a message. I'm forgiven. The Prophet ﷺ received a verse telling him that he has been forgiven. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, surely we have opened up a path to clear triumph for you, so that Allah may forgive you your past and future sins, complete His grace upon you, guide you to the straight path, and help you mightily. You know what he did?
He stood up praying all night and crying all night until his feet swelled. And Lady Aisha said, how can you do this to yourself? You're the one whom Allah told that he has been forgiven all his sins, even future sins, if you do any. He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا? Can't I be a thankful servant? He was not sincere and humble. He was the epitome of sincerity and humbleness. He was the embodiment of sincerity and humbleness, literally. His ego was completely under control. And this is a message to us as Muslims. Be careful with your ego. Your ego can be so dangerous. The ego is far more dangerous than the shaitan. Shaitan is nothing. Shaitan is weak. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. That the shaitan is so weak, but the ego is more, far more dangerous. Actually, what made shaitan become a shaitan? Was there a shaitan before the shaitan that made him become shaitan? It was Iblis. It was a beautiful creature, close to the angels, that when Allah ordered the angels an order, when he gave them a command, he was supposed to do like them. He was so close to the angels. And then what happened? He disobeyed. Why? Was there a devil before the devil to tell the devil to disobey? There wasn't. It's the I am the ego. I am better than him. You created me from fire and you created him from clay. I am white and he's black. Isn't it the same? I am European and he's Arab. I am Arab and he's Indian. It is the I, the ego, that destroyed Iblis and made him become shaitan. So the ego can make one become a shaitan, but can one of us, his ego make him a shaitan? Yes, of course. Are there human devils? Definitely there are human devils. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that there are human devils. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ عَدُوًا شَيَاطِينَ الْإِنسِ وَالْجِنِ. He said, in the same way we assign to each prophet an enemy from among the human devils and jinn devils. They suggest alluring words to one another in order to deceive. Yes, the ego, which is the source of all evil. The ego is the source of racism. The ego is the source of xenophobia, the source of Islamophobia, the source of antisemitism, the source of every evil on this world is the ego. And it can make people shaitans, actually. It made people already shaitans. Fir'aun. What destroyed Fir'aun? It is the I. وَنَادَى فِرْعَوْنُ فِي قَوْمِهِ قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ أَلَيْسَ لِي مُلْكُ مِصْرَ وَهَذِهِ الْأَنْهَارُ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِي أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. And Pharaoh proclaimed amongst his people, he said, my people, don't I have the sovereignty of Egypt? Don't I have sovereignty over Egypt and these rivers that flow beneath it? Don't you see? I have the sovereignty of Egypt. He became shaitan, a human devil. Qarun. Same thing. He said, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُ عَلَى عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. This wealth was given to me because of the knowledge I have. It's the I, it's the ego. How can we seek tarbiyah? How can we seek disciplining oneself? If it happens that anyone records a conversation between four or five people from us, from our community, for 2 hours conversation, and then listen to it, you know what you will hear? You will hear every one of them speaking about himself for about 30 to 45 minutes, speaking about his intelligence, about his wealth, about his credibility, about his courage, about his bravery, about highlighting his skills, highlighting himself. Idols that we have deep inside and we started to worship them, these egos. How can we control this ego? Through the discipline. That's a discipline process that I will talk to you about, inshallah. After Jalsat al-Istiraha, the Prophet said, At-ta'ibu Habibur Rahman, and he also said, At-ta'ibu bin al-dambi, kaman la dhanba lahu, the one who repents from a sin is exactly like a sinless person. He also said, Allah loves he who repents. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Rasulullah. All praise are due to Allah, the creator, the cherisher, and the sustainer of this universe, and may his peace and blessings be upon his noble Prophet Muhammad and his companions and descendants and for our dear respected brothers and sisters. You know, if Umar ibn Khattab was to hear this conversation, he would never imagine that those people are Muslims. Speak of themselves like that, about their handsomeness, charisma, smartness. He would never think that those are Muslim. It will make him sick, probably physically sick. Because we are sick people. Maybe not physically sick, but spiritually sick. This is spiritual sickness. And there are four things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given us, every one of us. And he either gave it to them, to us, empty or weak. And he gave us tools to either fill them up or strengthen them. Those four things are al-aql, the faculty of reason, the mind, al-qalb, the heart, which are the feelings, al-ruh, your spirit, and al-jasad, your body. Every one of these was given to you weak or empty, and Allah gave you tools to fill it up or to strengthen it. Aql, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, هُوَ الَّذِي أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَجَعَلَكُمْ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Allah says, he got you out from your mother's wombs with no knowledge. Zero knowledge. And then he gave you the seeing sense, the hearing sense, and your brains in order to be thankful, which means he gave you tools to fill up those empty minds, empty from knowledge. So the one who will ignore the process of tarbiyah for his mind, he will suffer from ignorance. So what you do here for your mind is you seek knowledge. When you seek knowledge, you can avoid becoming ignorant. But is it enough to become knowledgeable? No. You need to take care of the rest of the things. Your heart. If you stop any Christian on the street and tell him to tell you about Christianity, and he will tell you that we were all born with the original sin. We as Muslims believe exactly the opposite. That we were all born with an original goodness. God Almighty wrote on our hard drives the ability to know Him and get close to Him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with good hearts, clean and pure, ready to submit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ. Every newborn is born in a state of innate nature, pure innate nature. And then his parents make him Jew or Christian or maybe. He didn't say I'll make a Muslim. Why? Because he was born Muslim. He was born Muslim on a state of innate nature. So we have clean hearts ready to submit. The problem with these hearts are that they are like mobile batteries. They die every day if they are not charged. So you need to put it on a charger every day. What is this charger? The charger you have in iman? It is... Dhikrullah, the dhikr. And the dhikr is of different types. The most important type of dhikr is the Qur'an. Allah called the Qur'an a dhikr. In the Qur'an it says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. It is me who descended the dhikr, and it's me who will preserve it. How do we deal with the Qur'an? Because some of us are very happy and very proud of themselves. Alhamdulillah, we memorize the Qur'an. Some of us even memorize it all. And so on. But actually, is this the case? Isn't it that the only book in the world, that if you ask someone to read it, he asks you this silly question: should I read it with understanding or without understanding? Isn't it the Quran? This is our contribution to the Quran. We made it the only book in the world which is read without understanding. See, mashallah, we come to the day of judgment and say, oh Allah, we used to read your book every day, but without understanding. Out of what? Out of respect. Is this respect? مَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They did not render to Allah the respect that he deserves. That's what the ayah says. So this is our case with the Quran. Salah, same thing. MashaAllah, we pray 5 times a day. We pray, so what can you pray in the mosque 5 times a day? Is that true? Or is this what the neighbors see? They see us coming to pray every time, every day, 5 times, but some of us 5 times in the mosque, mashallah. But do we really pray in the mosque? Isn't it that when the imam says, Allahu Akbar, we all go, Allahu Akbar, and then we start planning. Directly after Salah, I have to go to the supermarket and buy the list that my wife gave me. I shouldn't forget the bread, because actually there's no bread for the kids' sandwiches tomorrow. And of course, because I'm afraid of forgetting the bread, I keep reminding myself during the Salah, bread, bread, bread. And I start planning for 30 years ahead. I want to change my car, I want to change my house, I want to do PhD, I want to have, and then all of a sudden, when I'm in the year 2445, I hear the imam saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And I go, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And I go out, fetch my shoes, go outside, wear my shoes outside the mosque, because I shouldn't wear my shoes outside the mosque, mashallah, I'm righteous. I'm a righteous person. And the neighbors say, mashallah, this man goes to pray in the mosque 5 times a day. They don't know. But I plan in the mosque 5 times a day. Isn't that the case? The adhkar, do we do our adhkar? What if I spill some water on one of the brothers? What should I say to apologize? Sorry, right? How can I say sorry to a brother? What if I tell him 100% sorry like that? Sorry, 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 like 100 times. Will he make feel that I'm really sorry? Or will it be more provocative for him? That's exactly what we do with Allah. Huh? When we say, Sakhullah, 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 like that. That's why Lady Ra'a al-Adawiyya said, إِنَّ اسْتِغْفَارَ يَحْتَاجُ إِلَى اسْتِغْفَارَ. Our istighfar means istighfar. We need to seek forgiveness from Allah for the way we seek forgiveness from Allah. So we need to read the Quran the right way. We need to pray the right way. We need to, what's that? And we call ourselves Muslims. And we ask Allah, why is Allah doing this to us? Excuse me. Allah will not change you until you change yourself. This is just one part, which is the tarbiyah imaniyah for the heart. Come, let's come to the ego. And see the ego that is inside every one of us. It became like idols and we all worship it. We keep on criticizing everything in this world except ourselves. We criticize our spouses, criticize our parents, criticize our government, criticize the neighbors, criticize the children, but we never criticize ourselves. Why? The very first lesson in history was self-criticism. The very first lesson in history. When Adam ate from the tree, Adam and Eve ate from the tree, and then what happened? They got stuck. They didn't know what to do. Because actually Allah taught Adam all the needs. But not all the concepts. Some concepts were left until it's time for it to be a big lesson, a strong lesson. One of them is the concept of repentance. They ate, they got stuck, they didn't know what to do until Allah taught them. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَبَ عَلَيْهِ. Adam received words from Allah to use to repent. What are these words? To say astaghfirullah 1,000 times? 10,000 times? 1,000,000 times? Say, قَالَ يَا رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. He said, oh Lord, indeed we wronged ourselves. Self-discipline. And then, if you forgive us not, we will be losers. We don't have to be able to do it. So number one, self-criticism. That's why I have an announcement for you. After the khutbah, right here, I'll stand up and make a small announcement for you. That's why I came all the way from London to make this announcement, inshallah, about the spiritual discipline. We have a program that will start in Bradford soon, inshallah. I want to see you all in this, inshallah, program, inshallah. And that is the body. Because actually someone can be very knowledgeable. He took care of his mind and he acquired knowledge. He can also be very pious and very righteous and have a strong iman, read the Quran with tadabbur and reflection, make salah with khushu', abkar with khushu', and be very humble and very sincere. But he can be lazy. And the society doesn't benefit from him. If you bring two cups of tea, and you put in one of them 10 lumps of sugar, and in the other one, 2 only. And keep the one that had the 10 lumps of sugar without stirring, and only stir the one that had the 2 lumps. Which one will taste sweeter? The one that had the 2 lumps. Why? Because there's a movement. And the movement made the difference. He moved. So that's why we need to be active in our societies, volunteer with some organizations, help the poor, help, and so on. So it's about being balanced. You shouldn't have iman, but ignorant. You should be knowledgeable. You should be having strong iman and humble and active. How can I be balanced in taking care of my discipline or disciplining myself in a balanced way? These are the things that we came with to you today.